stories.
Negative.
We should focus on the good stories, you know.
But you can't blame them, can you, Dai? I mean, if you think about it, I mean, where's the example of oil for Ghanaians? It's Nigeria. They haven't done the greatest job of it. I mean, that's what people see.
Well, that's what they see too, but we need to also show them that there are good stories.
Because such as what? You keep saying that,
well,
such as what? Where
one of
Norway, everybody says Norway.
Well, we could say Norway, but I think I prefer to talk about Trinidad and Tobago, where Trinidad was a country, again, where most of its industry is offshore, and they have developed their industry over the past 30 to 40 years.
Has it translated to, wealth for that country?
Yeah,
I'm curious. I mean,
yeah, it's translated to wealth. It's translated to a massive change in the standard of living. It's created an education system that's probably the best in the Caribbean. But most importantly now, it's created an oil industry in Trinidad where they first of all build their own oil storage and producing platforms in the country itself now. But also they can export that technology, and Trinidadians now work out throughout the world in the oil and gas industry.
You're saying that's the example we should be looking
at? I'm saying that's a good example. And I'm picking that one because if I picked the North Sea, people would say I was biased and prejudiced towards the UK. But I would say that Aberdeen, people should remember Aberdeen as it was a small and is a small Scottish fishing village that, again, 40 years ago was not a lot different to what we're talking
and
about.
And has been transformed into a nice modern city as a result of that.
With excellent education establishments.
And you think that's possible here?
If we have an oil industry, and I need to caution you to say that one oil field, you know, Aberdeen now has 200 oil fields.
Yeah, but you see, that's, that's fine, but that's tricky. So what are you suggesting, that if you don't have numerous oil fields, then there is no industry and therefore no real substantial benefit for communities, for the country? Is that what you're saying?
No, I'm saying that one oil field only provide a certain amount of employment and benefit to the communities, to the country, to the government, to have a much more sustainable development and a much larger impact.
You need more.
You
more,
need more.
Much more of it.
Because more industry means more jobs, more people, more investment, and obviously greater revenue for the country, greater taxes for the country, and greater oil and gas from the country. So that means all of those things.
Let's talk about that in a little more detail. Now, you have a petroleum agreement as a company, all the different companies, with the GNPC. And obviously there are various terms and so on. Sometimes we get the impression that much of the returns will go to the investor and the oil company. Other times we get a sense that with a mix of equity, royalty, additional oil entitlement and so on, significant returns, in fact the majority will be in Ghana. What's the position? The way it's distributed, Ghana gets a big chunk. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Really?
Yes, because you have to remember that the way those agreements are written, and they're not just unique to our project, I mean they're standard licenses for offshore Ghana. These petroleum agreements, there is tax, there's royalty, there's oil allowance, and there's just simple revenue to the government, plus GNPC has a 13.75% interest in the field. So you add that on top, and therefore they get something close to 51% of the revenues will go to the government of Ghana.
But you see what I mean? That's quite strange to hear you say, because it is so easy for all everybody else to understand that very little comes to Ghana, all of it goes somewhere. That's the feeling. So why is that? Why do you think that is?
I don't know, because they obviously don't look at the big picture, which is where you've got to look at tax, royalties, oil allowances.
But they don't consider tax. They assume that if you don't make any profit, you don't, although I wouldn't imagine you're not making profit at $70 a barrel, but they assume that if you don't make any profit, then there's no tax, so you cannot say that's a benefit.
Well, we will be paying tax, I can assure you, from day one.
Yeah.
We will pay tax, we will pay revenues, we'll pay royalties, and that's all the way the agreement's written. So we and all the partners will be
paying. Are
they paying
fair?
That.
Are the agreements fair? I mean,
yes,
it's
the
difficult.
They
need
fair.
A balance. That's to keep you guys interested, but have to keep Ghanaians happy. Are they fair?
They're fair.
Is it okay for them to vary from, if you like, agreement to agreement, or should there be a flat way that everybody works with?
Well, what you have to look at is an evolution of licensing terms in any country depends on its history for oil and gas exploration. I mean, you know, you mentioned Norway earlier on, and these other countries, I mean, they didn't start off with a uniform scheme and system of licenses. It took them a long time to get to a system where they had a very well-managed organization, a well-managed regulatory system, a framework. All those things have to come in place. When you get standardization and formal processes, then you can have all those things in place. But until you have those, so it's an evolutionary thing. It doesn't, everything doesn't just slot into place from day one. It all has to come with time, with growth, with success.
And but you're happy with the Ghanaian environment. I mean, the policy environment.
Yeah,
I mean,
Tullow's very happy. Tullow's very happy.
So Ghana, and how does Ghana compares favorably with other parts of the world? That's the point I'm making.
Yeah, in general terms, what Ghana has been able to do is benefit from those things that we've just talked about, Norway, UK, Trinidad, and license terms. And there are what are called model contracts, model terms. Mm. And, you know, the World Bank has these, all the institutions have them. Mm. So everything is based upon those pre-existing model contracts and terms and agreements. Mm. So there's nothing unique, if you like, or different. There are some terms that are different that have to fit the legislation of a country or its tax rules and regulations. Those are the differences from country to country.
Better than cream cheese and bagels, better than honey on bread, better than champagne and pretzels, better than breakfast in bed, better than chili rellenos, better than chocolate eclairs, better than hothouse tomatoes, better than fresh Bartlett pears, better than dining a la carte or simply gastronomic art, better than anything except being in love.